The following podcast is part of a certified educational activity titled Advancing ADCs in Gynecologic Cancers, Expert Insights on Recent Evidence, Implementation Strategies, and Patient Care. Access the entire activity and complete the post-test at peerview.com/VRN860. Downloadable slides and practice aids are also available.
Good morning. My name is Brad Monk, and I'm a gynecologic oncologist now from Florida, and it's my privilege to welcome you bright and early on a Sunday to Advancing ADCs in Gynecologic Cancers, Expert Insights on Recent Evidence, Implementation Strategies, and Patient Care. I'm so happy to be here. Today, my panelists, my friends, my colleagues, my esteemed experts, Anna, introduce yourself.
Okay. Sorry. My name is Anna Wagner. I am medical oncology by training, and I'm heading gynecological cancer program in Barcelona, Spain. It's my great pleasure to be here today with my esteemed colleague. Thank you for coming.
And my GOG co-leader, thank you. Katie, say hi.
Good morning, everyone. We're so excited to see such a full room on a Sunday morning. We're all impressed by you. You should give yourself a round of applause. I'm Kathleen Moore. I am the deputy director of the Stevenson Cancer Center in Oklahoma City, and as Brad said, associate director of GOG Partners, and very excited to have you all here today.
We want to augment your knowledge regarding the rationale for all of the data accumulating very quickly on antibody drug conjugates and really equip you, weaponize you to go back home and treat your patients with these wonderful agents. And we've sort of pivoted because we realize that we even need to partner more. We already partner, but more with patients and patient advocacy groups, and ultimately to maximize clinical benefit and minimize adverse events. So thank you to the National Ovarian Cancer Coalition. They're outside. They have a number of resources for patients, and also information for biomarkers and clinical trials and side effect management. And our sister organization, the Foundation for Women's Cancer, they've really been a great partner. The GOG Foundation is now aligning ourselves with the Foundation for Women's Partner, for Women's Cancer. We're one family. And we're also facilitating a partnership with the SGO. So we're trying to bring everyone together so that we can accomplish our common goal. So I'll begin, talk a little bit, maybe 5 minutes about antibody drug conjugates. We'll rely on, thank you, Anna, for coming from Barcelona. And then ultimately I'll say to talk about endometrial, and I'll talk a little bit about cervix, and Katie will wrap it up with her wonderful work and your work on ovarian cancer. So I remember 2005, we described the single-agent activity of bevacizumab in ovarian cancer, and ultimately 2007, cervical cancer. And I'm like, we found it. We found a targeted agent, but we had to learn how to deal with hypertension and proteinuria and all of these things. And we did it. And then in 2014, we got accelerated approval, remember, for olaparib, BRCA mutated. And we're like, oh, oral medications. We had to learn about that, and you did it. And then in 2017, think of the journey. Number three, immune therapy for MSI agnostic tumors. Now you guys know a lot about immune therapy, and we have multiple indications, as you know, in cervical and endometrial cancer. Well, we're going to do it again. We're going to introduce a fourth class of agents, quite frankly, that you have experience with. We have two approvals, as you know, mirvetuximab soravtansine and tisotumab vedotin, but this is early on. And so I get it, you're a great antiangiogenic doctor, you're a great PARP doctor and a great IO doctor, and we're going to become together ADC doctors. And you're going to see, just like antiangiogenic across all tumor types, and IO across all tumor types, and maybe PARP across several tumor types, where ADCs can be used broadly and maybe even over and over again. So it's pretty exciting. We really have an opportunity here to answer some key questions. Yes, what are the benefits, but also what are the adverse events, and really how to use them for the right patient at the right time, and as I always say, to get the right results. So we're still learning. Again, this is early on. We've done it before. This is now version 4. I think all of us understand the composition and structure of an antibody-drug conjugate. If I was to point out to you the key thing, probably the one that you understand the least, it's the linker. You'll see that there's multiple overlapping mechanisms of action for the payload. You'll see that there are some situations where the antibody is identical. Absolutely, there are multiple overlapping molecules for the same target. What's the major difference? The linker. Think about that. I think the three of us, we need to learn more about the linkers. Hydrophobic, hydrophilic, the bulk of the ADC, and quite frankly, the construct. It's really exciting that we can enrich the cytotoxic payload into the tumor microenvironment. The intention is then that they're internalized and then through in a liposome disassociated. And as the cell dies, the payload is released into the tumor microenvironment for bystander effect. One of the challenges, again, relative to the target, is I am sort of torn. Is a biomarker a good thing because it helps us pick the right patient, or is it a bad thing? And the two ADCs that we have approved, one is heavily biomarker-informed, and the other is not. And I'm not sure which is better. I think we have to be able to pivot based on the biology and, quite frankly, the expression. But if you look at tissue factor, which is expressed on almost all cervical cancer cells, you know, folate receptor alpha is also expressed on most ovarian cancer tumors. So it's a very challenging landscape as we understand what the biomarker threshold is. And it's not just what the biomarker is, it's how it's measured. So I love this slide. There are at least three ways to evaluate HER2. So overexpression, immunohistochemistry, amplification, in situ hybridization, or mutation through next-gen sequencing. What's the right way? Hey, good question. Okay. What's the overlap? In other words, is every amplified overexpressed? How do you do that? Again, good question. And we're trying to sort this out. If you saw us huddled right here, we were trying to answer this very question, is what's the best way to evaluate HER2? And you know what the answer is? Yes. Make sure you evaluate it, because we see all too often tumors that have not had a HER2 evaluation. So we're going to hear more about that. Tissue factor was the first opportunity in cervical cancer. It's part of the coagulation cascade. You know tisotumab vedotin well. I'll review it quickly. It really created an opportunity to fill an unmet need in the second line setting. Folate receptor alpha, again, thanks to many of you for both tisotumab vedotin and mirvetuximab for allowing us to evaluate the biomarker study through the GOG at ENGOT. Thank you. This opportunity and ultimately bring it to the patient. So you're going to see, remember I said it's early on, you're going to see TROP2, multiple TROP2 antibodies, okay? You're going to see B7H4. You're going to see, and we already saw the beautiful data, thank you, Katie, CDH6, mesothelin, and others, NaPi2b. Just because the Mersana product didn't work doesn't mean that that's not a good target. So we're excited. Here it breaks down, again, the target, the antibody, the linker, the payload, and what the regulatory status is. So I'm going to turn it over to my good friend. Thank you. Welcome. And away. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Brad, for the kind introduction. Thank you all for coming, you know, this Sunday morning in this beautiful San Diego to learn. It's always a pleasure. So my task in this session is to talk about ADC in endometrial cancer. So I think it's like kind of mandatory to start talking about trastuzumab deruxtecan. you know very well this ADC, but in a brief manner, let me point it out the main characteristic for trastuzumab deruxtecan: a high potent payload, a topoisomerase 1, a high DAR, what that is mean, drug antibody ratio equal to 8, and an important bystander anti-tumor effect. While there's a plethora of knowledge of trastuzumab deruxtecan in several solid tumors, such as breast cancer, in the gyne field, we are making our first step. However, the preliminary data that we have so far are really, really promising. We learned the data from trastuzumab deruxtecan in gyne tumor through this important study that is called Destiny Pan-Tumor 02. Destiny Pan-Tumor 02 is a open-label, multicenter study enrolling overexpressing HER2 tumor. We enroll patients who have progressed to different standard lines of therapy, and all the patients must have tumor that express HER2, either 2+ or 3+. The determination of overexpression could be either local or central. For those patients who didn't have the opportunity to have a central determination, so local determination, sorry, then it was performed at the central. And when this determination was performed centrally, it's something very important that you need to keep in mind. You know, they follow the gastric guideline determined by ASCO and CAP. And then we treated all patients with trastuzumab deruxtecan, 5.4 milligram every 3 weeks. Primary endpoint of the Destiny Pan-Tumor, overall response rate. Secondary endpoint, very important, duration of response, PFS, and overall survival. In a general manner, I would like to point out that we enroll a heavily pretreated population. Approximately more than 40% of the patients had received at least 3 prior lines of therapy. I think it's important that you keep in mind this information to better understand the outcome that I will show right now. Here you are, the overall response rate across the gynecological tumor. Let's start focusing on endometrial cancer. In the whole cohort, the overall response rate was 57%. When we break down the responses according to the expression of HER2, as expected, in 3+, the overall response rate was 84%, and in 2+, 47%. And very remarkable, despite having a small sample size, look at the responses in those patients with HER1+ and 0, 25% and 60% respectively. And then we move to the cervical cancer. Once again, heavily pretreated population, metastatic cervical, recurrent cervical cancer. In the whole population, 50%, 3+, 75%, and once again, very remarkable as something that we need to investigate further. In those patients without expression, 2 out of 4 patients responded to trastuzumab deruxtecan. And finally, ovarian cancer is still to be a little bit less exciting. The overall response rate was 45% and the 3+, 63%. And I see the secondary endpoint was duration of response. The median follow-up in the Destiny Pan-Tumor at that stage when we analyzed this data was approximately 13 months. The median duration of response was not yet reached in the endometrial cancer cohort, in the whole cohort, in the 3+, was not reached in the cervical cancer for those tumors with 3+. Indeed, we have the median duration of response in the different ovarian cancer population according to the overexpression of 3+. And what about the PFS and overall survival? They are secondary endpoint, but I think they are very informative for our patients. If we look at endometrial cancer, in the 3+, the PFS, the median PFS, has not yet been reached. And the median overall survival was 26 months. We can learn more about this biomarker in the presentation that was delivered yesterday by Professor Vicky Mapper. Then we move to the cervical cancer. Bear in mind, heavily pretreated, recurrent, patients with cervical cancer. The median PFS in the 3+ has not yet been reached, median follow-up 13 months, and the median overall survival, amazing, has not yet been reached either for those patients with tumor 3+. And then finally, ovarian cancer, the median PFS in the 3+, 12 months, and the median overall survival approximately 20 months. As a summary, I would like to point out once again that we are talking about the heavily pretreated population. So we can say that despite having a small sample size, 40% in every single tumor, the results are really promising. Indeed, in light of this result, the guideline NCCN, they have listed the indication of trastuzumab deruxtecan for HER2-positive tumor, either 3+ or 2+, and even more important, FDA has announced a priority review for those tumors with 3+. We expect approximately Q2 2024 the approval for this drug. So, we have reviewed the efficacy, there's no doubt, but there is something that we need to take into consideration when we are talking about the ADC in the safety profile. If we start on the right of the slide, the most common treatment emerging adverse events for trastuzumab deruxtecan in dark blue are the hematologic toxicity, neutropenia, anemia, thrombocytopenia, and GI toxicity, nausea and diarrhea. However, despite these figures, the rate of discontinuation due to treatment-emerging adverse event is quite low, 5.8%. And what is the main concern related with trastuzumab deruxtecan? Maybe some of you are also treating patients with breast cancer, is the ILD, pneumonitis. When you look at the global incidence of pneumonitis in the gynecological cancer cohort, it's only 10%. And the most important, the majority of this ILD were grade 1 and grade 2. But there's something that we should learn, and we have learned with another new target, new drug, is how to detect and how to prevent and how to treat this adverse event associated with trastuzumab deruxtecan. The first thing that we should keep in mind is to screen. Screening means, you know, to rule out any kind of thing of symptom that the patient may have related with ILD. And the gold standard to do that is the CT scan, high resolution CT scan. You cannot start any treatment with trastuzumab deruxtecan without performing a high resolution CT scan. Despite having a baseline, a normal CT scan without any sign of ILD, this CT scan should be repeatedly every 6 weeks during the patient journey treatment. Another important thing, education. Education of patients, education of general practitioner, education of the clinical nurse. We need to advise, we need to teach all these stakeholders what are the signs or symptoms for the ILD. Why? Because if we are able to detect early, we will be able to implement the best therapy for our patient, and then we will prevent from a further development or more severe event. As soon as we detect that the patient is developing an ILD, trastuzumab deruxtecan should always, and I say always, be interrupted. And then you need to start treatment. And the treatment of election treatment for ILD is steroids. You start with steroids and then you closely follow your patient. And it's very important that you incorporate in your team pneumologists. This multidisciplinary approach is always much better than try to treat your patient by yourself. Build a multidisciplinary team with your pneumologist, and I guess that the patient will have a better outcome. So when the toxicity is solved, and then you can resume the therapy, but you need to be very careful. You need to trade off risk and benefit, you know, as soon the patient has developed this kind of toxicity. So, what else beyond trastuzumab deruxtecan? We are very lucky. We have a plethora of ADC under clinical development. One of the most promising new ADC is DB1303, BEN-NT323. I mean, with this new drug, this ADC, the payload is also a topoisomerase 1 in the phase 1 escalation, enrolling 78 patients with endometrial cancer. We have observed an amazing overall response rate around 30%. And due to this outcome, FDA has announced a breakthrough designation. What else on the horizon? Another target. When I say target, is that the ADC is targeting this tumor antigen. One of them is TROP2. What is TROP2? TROP2 is a glycoprotein transmembrane that is expressed in normal tissue, but is overexpressed in a variety of solid tumors, including endometrial cancer. We have preliminary data from the Santin work using sacituzumab govitecan, that is an ADC that has been approved for triple negative breast cancer for GU disease. And this ADC has also a topoisomerase 1 and payload. And in the work developed by Santin group in a heavily pretreated endometrial cancer population, they also show a really promising overall response rate of 22%. And then, you know, we have this also new ADC that has been developed by Merck. It's called MK2870. And I would like to point out that the payload of this anti-TROP2 is quite similar to the payload that we have seen in the SASI. It's another topoisomerase 1. It's a belotecan derivative. And then, you know, according to the preliminary data in a phase 1 trial that are not in the public domain, so I cannot share with you, but the toxicity was quite manageable and the efficacy very promising, according with the GOG PI by me, Professor Monk, and the ENGOT PI is Professor Loruso. They have developed this interesting trial. Why say this interesting trial? Because from now and onward, all clinical trials should include populations who have been treated with immunotherapy. And then we need to find new drugs that are active in this new population. So this is the reason why they are going to enroll patients with endometrial cancer who had progressed after immunotherapy, and then they will randomize those patients to receive this new anti-TROP dose, MK2870, every 2 weeks, every 14 days, and the other arm will be the standard therapy that we have so far, doxorubicin or weekly paclitaxel. The primary endpoint will be a dual primary endpoint, PFS and OS. And if I'm correct, Brad, the trial is about to start enrollment.
Already started.
In the state, right?
Mm-hmm.
Wonderful.
And around the world.
We are about to, in my sight.
I know.
So, what else? I mean, this is another important ADC targeting B7-H4. This is an immune checkpoint ligand with an overexpression in a variety of solid tumors, including breast, ovarian, and endometrial. So far, we have data only from the phase 1 dose escalation, but we have seen that in patients with ovarian cancer and endometrial cancer, this new ADC have shown activity, and there's another ADC also targeting this ligand in development, ACD8205, among them.
Next, there's a case here that sort of to make you think. As you know, endometrial cancer has been the most common gynecologic cancer for some time and now is the most lethal in the States. It's a grade 3 endometrioid tumor. We profile them. She's MSI high. Even today, the patients with recurrent disease have not had a chance to get Ruby or GY018, so it's not uncommon to say a recurrent patient is checkpoint naive. And as part of the profiling, you see a HER2 IHC3 plus gastric score, another good message, thank you. So now what do? You go, oh, I'm MSI high, I give her that, let me give her checkpoint. Garnet, thank you for your work on that. Dostarlimab, 158. pembrolizumab, or now that it's NCCN recommended, I can give her trastuzumab deruxtecan. What's the right answer?
I would say firstly that there's no right answer. This is very important. I think we should take into consideration several clinical features to make the decision. I will start for the 3+. How this 3+ was determined? We have seen in the Destiny Pan-Tumor 02 that there is more than 40% of discrepancy when we determine the 3+ between the local test and the central test. Why have we seen these discrepancies? One, tumor heterogeneity. Second, antibody use. Third, pathologies determination. Four, the score that the pathology have used. So we need to be sure that the patient is 3+ according to the Destiny Pan-Tumor 02, because according to this guideline is when we have seen that those patients with 3+ achieve this amazing greater overall response rate of more than 50%. If we are sure that the patient is 3+, then we need to look at the clinical status of the patient. Why I say that? We know that the immunotherapy in endometrial cancer, MSI high, is the ideal drug. I have been developing the Garnet trial, but the IO takes time to get response. The average time to get response is 8 weeks. However, with trastuzumab deruxtecan, we see quicker responses. So if the patient has a large volume of the disease, the patient is very symptomatic, my first option should be treat the patient with trastuzumab deruxtecan. If it's not the case that the patient doesn't have a large volume of the disease, the patient is doing quite well, then I think that I will start with IO, because we have seen with the IO, it's not only the responses, it's the duration of response. With dostarlimab, those patients will respond at 27 months, the 87% of the responders were still in response. It's true that in the trastuzumab deruxtecan, with the median follow-up that we have, those patients 3+, they have not yet reached the median duration of response. So for me, in summary, two key points. To be sure that the patient, the tumor is 3+, and the clinical feature of the patient at the moment to make the decision on therapy.
Thank you. Very clear. We have a lot of on the iPad. Thank you for asking your questions. A lot of questions about testing. You said IHC. There's a question here that says, well, in my cancer center, the breast individuals for 2+, which is the next part of the question, would reflex to insight to hybridization. Was ISH used in PanDestiny? Do you do that? Or tell me how you'd handle a 2+ patient, Katie.
So ISH was not used in PanDestiny. It was gastric scoring. So gastric scoring of 2+, 3+. So it's different than breast. And this is one of the big, confusing points. We all have this agent now, at least in the U.S., available for NCCN. And I'm glad for that, because it makes a drug available that our patients desperately need. But it's based on 40 patients. And one type of scoring and other antibody drug conjugates you mentioned, the duality BioNTech agent is breast scoring, and we're seeing the same level of efficacy in that agent as well. So I think the truthful answer, Dr. Monk, at this point is we do not know how best to identify the patients with endometrial cancer who are going to get the most benefit from these antibody drug conjugates, one, and two, for sequencing, which combination of biomarkers say you go right to trastuzumab deruxtecan or BNT323, or Len-Pem is your best option right now, and this is another good option, but Len-Pem's better. We don't have that level of discernment yet, and this is why even though the drug is available in the U.S., clinical trial enrollment is still critical, because we have a lot to learn to best take care of our patients.
And then in IO failures, they would get our study that you're doing with sacituzumab. Different, it's not govitecan, it's sacituzumab, and the second part of that name will come. So practically today, Katie, today you are using mostly IHC, mostly gastric to triage these patients?
Yeah, mostly at our site right now, we send everything out to, I'll just say, we send everything out to Caris. I'm not doing a Caris commercial, but that's what we do. And I actually asked them, because we had an argument one day on how they were scoring it, and they are using gastric scoring. So by default, we're doing all of our testing with them, and we get gastric scoring. There's no ish. We get amplification because it's part of the panel, but it's all our eligibility for looking at patients for this agent is all based on IHC right now.
Well, thank you. And thank you for your contribution to the clinical trials. All of the data that we're sharing with you, of course, clinical trial data that you contributed to. So again, we can't do this without patients. We can't do it with pharma sponsors. And most importantly, we can't do it without you. So the breakthrough really in cervical cancer antibody drug conjugates has been tisotumab vedotin. The breakthrough for the Europe, particularly since we've had it available in the U.S. through the accelerated approval process, is Innova TV301. Again, a GOGN-GOT collaboration that many of you participated in. It was second line, second and third line, and randomized 502 patients versus physician's choice chemotherapy and tisotumab vedotin at 2 milligrams per kilogram every 3 weeks. And this is the same control arm that was used in the Empower study that you did with cemiplimab. It will be the same probably control arm in further cervical cancer randomized phase 3 trials. And our good friend from ENGOT, Ignace Vergote, presented this at ESMO. Now you may say, really, Monk, really? That's all you got? Yeah, that's all I got, okay? But that is a statistically significant, and I would argue, clinically relevant improvement in overall survival, as well as PFS. And if you were in the opening session, as I was, and when that patient got up there and said, you know, a patient of Dr. Leslie Randall at Virginia Commonwealth, Richmond, Virginia, and I had stage 4 cervical cancer, and I was dying, and I may still be dying, but I'm alive. And that was so inspiring to me, and I actually went up right after and thanked her, and my message to her was, never give up, never, ever give up. And that's a Jimmy Villano quote. So you can see here the waterfall plots. I'm asked all the time that the accelerated approval was 24% ORR. Here it's 18%. Why? They're sort of the same numbers. It's still proven that there is tumor shrinkage better than what is best available therapy. There were CRs in the tisotumab vedotin-treated patient population, and there were no CRs in the investigator choice chemotherapy. Presented at this meeting by Brian Slomovitz, the team looked at tissue factor expression. They saw that overall response rate trends were consistent regardless of tissue factor expression. So again, you may say, well, I wish I had a biomarker. You also may say, I'm glad it's available for all patients. But this was a good disclosure. Again, everything that we say from enthusiasm has to be balanced. The AEs of special interest include ocular, which is really a surface. So the cornea, sclera, conjunctiva, peripheral neuropathy. The payload here is an antitubulin agent. And because it is in the tissue factor cascade, bleeding. The good news is that the dose continuation rate because of ocular peripheral neuropathy occurred in only 5.6% of patients. So in other words, you can keep it going. And we didn't really get into it, trastuzumab deruxtecan. These are chemotherapeutic agents. These are cytotoxics. Again, they're concentrated in the tumor microenvironment, but interruption and dose reduction is really an important option, particularly here with the neuropathy. And you guys know how to give the patient a little bit of a break, let her neuropathy get better, and then ultimately dose reduce. We really want to mitigate the ocular toxicity. It is several opportunities. One is to limit the exposure. We limit the exposure two ways, vasoconstriction and cold packs. So you put the cold pack on, you give a vasoconstricting eye drop. The second is that we treat what might happen, right, through corticosteroid drops, 3 drops for 3 days. And then also we go ahead and try to dilute it. secret to pollution is dilution. That's what I always say in the operating room. It's irrigate, right? So I think we have this figured out. I point out to you that in the clinical trials, ocular exams were only done at baseline. But in the clinical trial, it's every in approval, it's every cycle. It'll be interesting to see what happens in Europe, and when this happens, whether you'll need to do what we do and do it every dose, or whether you can do it at baseline. It's a little different in Europe because we have optometrists that can give and prescribe medicines. So we can send the patient to the ocular professional, the optometrist, and they can prescribe whatever's necessary, and that's not the situation in Europe. So we also can combine tisotumab vedotin with other agents. This is a paper that I'm very proud of as the last author. We can combine it with three other active agents, carboplatin, pembrolizumab, and that's very exciting. Pembrolizumab both in the first line and in the second line, also with bevacizumab, which is not on this slide. So again, this is sort of a typical scenario, and I'm so excited that we can talk about sequencing. That was really your case, Anna. Think of it, right? So here, you know, recurrent cervical cancer that can't be treated with radiation or surgery, metastatic. And again, many of our patients today, as much as you know that I am attached to KEYNOTE-826, bevacizumab, pembrolizumab, chemo in the first line, many patients still get to the second line and are IO naive. And we don't have cemiplimab in this country, but we have it in other parts of the world, especially Japan, where it's the preferred agent. But we have pembrolizumab. So in this IO sort of naive patient in the second line, you got two options. You can give it to tisotumab vedotin, I just showed you, or you can give them her IO or both. Katie, what do you think? IO, TV, or both in the second line checkpoint naive patient?
Second line checkpoint naive.
TV alone, IO, or combination? I like, she's so thoughtful. She's like, yeah, that's a hard question.
It is a hard question. It is a hard question. And I think I would think about the, it comes down to the patient, to be honest.
Right?
So, you know, if you have a patient who's recurred with like node-only disease and you've picked it up on CT and she feels good and is PD-L1 positive, I probably would favor IO. Monotherapy IO, very well tolerated, could work really well. I'm not battling symptoms.
Right.
If I have a patient in my normal kind of presentation is patients don't usually present kind of asymptomatic, like, darn, I have a lymph node, they hurt. So if I have someone that's hurting or has a pending visceral crisis and I need to get a fast response, then I'm been much more likely to use tisotumab because the time to onset of response is really quick as opposed to immune therapies that take, you know, some months. If you're going to see anything at all, you know right away if tisotumab's working. So that's kind of how I've based it thus far. I haven't tried to combine the two. I know you have talked about that and Dr. Randall has talked about it. I tend to use, you know, monotherapy in this setting. And if they are IONA, which is increasingly uncommon in the U.S., I base it on symptoms.
Go ahead, Anna.
If I may, I think that you are aware that we published the sub-analysis in the cemiplimab trial according to the location of the metastasis. And then we saw those patients who had liver mets. Unfortunately, there was no difference between chemotherapy and cemiplimab. So it's something that we should also take into consideration when we make the decision in our patient, mainly because, I mean, liver met, we know that if don't treat it in a fast manner, it could be life-threatening.
So we put sort of the HER2 discussion in the endometrial because that's where it's the most common. What is the overexpression of HER2 in cervical cancer, either one of you? Because that's an option here too, right?
It is an option here. And really, we've known this for a long time. It's mainly an adenocarcinoma finding, but not entirely. I've definitely had one or two with squamous cell where you have kind of found these random ERBB2, mostly amplifications, but it's mainly adenocarcinoma. And it widely varies based on the subtype of adenocarcinoma. So you get into these really small numbers. But in general, I think you could say of adenocarcinomas of the cervix, up to 40% have some HER2 expression. And all of them should be at this point tested or catch up testing, in my opinion, because the benefit of this is just unprecedented.
And she said her BB2. Remember, that's the same thing as her too.
Oh, I apologize. Yeah, her BB2. Yeah. Sorry about that.
We are this today. If I may, you know, recently there's a very interesting meta-analysis published, 25 study, and they analyze the overexpression of HER2 in cervical cancer according to the guideline use. I mean, the ASCO guideline where I use, the prevalence of overexpression was 6%. But in the ASCO CAP guideline where not used, the prevalence was 28%. And in addition, you know, the MD Anderson by Funda Mary, they have recently published their series. It's true that the number of patients was quite small, but they reported a prevalence of 14%, 3+. So I think we are still far away to have reliable data on the overexpression of HER2 in cervical cancer.
Still IHC, still gastric, though, in your practical.
No.
Okay. That's great. Well, that was fun. Kathleen Moore, talk to us about what you work on every day.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay. Well, this is fun. I don't need my glasses because it's far away. All right. Let's talk about ovarian cancer. And we'll start with, I think Dr. Wachman said we start with the obvious in endometrial, which is the trastuzumab direct scan. And ovary, we'll start with the obvious, which is mirvetuximab soravtansine targeting folate receptor alpha. I think hopefully by now you all are familiar with folate receptor alpha as a target. It is a cell surface transmembrane protein highly expressed on epithelial ovarian cancer and then overexpressed at a high level in about 40% of cases. We have, and we'll talk about some of the other agents in this space, but have been really looking at exploiting folate receptor alpha for over a decade, and we finally succeeded with mirvetuximab soravtansine. So I'm showing you kind of the end of the story with mirvetuximab that we've had in recent years. In the U.S., we were fortunate enough to get accelerated approval, so we've had access to mirvetuximab since November of 2022 based on the SORAYA study, which was a single-arm phase 3, which is complicated, but that's what it was. That enrolled patients with platinum-resistant ovarian cancer, folate receptor alpha high. They all had to have prior bevacizumab exposure so that it qualified for accelerated approval in a high unmet need patient population. And the endpoint of this clinical trial was response rate and duration of response. And you can see the response rate here is 32%. And we benchmark that in a high unmet risk population against a response rate for monotherapy chemo, which we estimate at 15%. So that's clearly better. And the duration of response was about 7 months, and we like it to be more than 5.5 or 6 months. So it met the bar for accelerated approval. And as I said, we've had access to it here since 2022. But an accelerated approval isn't a confirmed approval, and it needs a global randomized phase 3 trial, which is what Mirasol accomplished. This was also in the platinum-resistant setting, although patients did not have to have been exposed to bevacizumab. They could be, but they didn't have to be. And it was also folate receptor alpha high only and randomized in this setting 1 to 3 priors to investigator's choice chemotherapy or mirvetuximab until progression or toxicity. And the primary endpoint was progression-free survival. Secondary analytic endpoints were overall response rate and overall survival. And so I'm just summarizing the reports here that you can see on the top, the progression-free survival, which was the first primary endpoint. This was met with a hazard ratio of 0.65, so 35% reduction in the hazard of progression or death with use of mirvetuximab as compared to physician's choice. Now, because that was positive, we could roll alpha to overall response rate, which was also positive. There was almost actually over a doubling of response rate from 16 to 42% with favoring mirvetuximab. So because that was positive, we rolled alpha to the interim overall survival analysis, which you see on the bottom part of this slide. And this had to have a very tight p-value in order to be positive at this interim assessment. So the p-value had to be less than 0.01313, and we hit that. So this is the final overall survival assessment because it was positive at the first interim analysis. We did reduce the risk of death with use of mirvetuximab by 33%, which is the first antibody drug conjugate and actually the first novel therapy ever in our history for platinum-resistant ovarian cancer to show an improvement in overall survival. And so this sets the bar now for what we're trying to accomplish with subsequent clinical trials. But we already have it here. We're very excited that this is being considered globally so we can bring this important medication to patients across the globe. Now, this does have a differentiated safety profile. We've been talking about this with the other antibody drug conjugates. These aren't non-toxic. I do believe they're less toxic, but they're not non-toxic. They just have different toxicities, and we have to mitigate them in different ways. So I know this is a busy slide. I'm going to walk you through it from left to right. Orange are all of the adverse events in the control arms, and it's paclitaxel, PLD, and topotecan from left to right on your screen. And in blue is the percentage of the same toxicity from rituximab. So if you start on the left-hand side, you see the hematologic toxicities. And really the summary here is that we really do not see hematologic toxicities at any appreciable rate with mirvetuximab as compared to investigator's choice chemotherapy, which is one of the nicest things about this medication other than its efficacy, because you can give your patient's bone marrow a break, honestly, while they're on this medication and they can recover, which may be why they survive for longer down the road, but that's a hypothesis. If you move one step over just to the general toxicities, you see neuropathy and alopecia. There is no alopecia with this medication. There is neuropathy, though, and it is cumulative. It's a microtubule toxin, so that makes sense. We see less than with weekly paclitaxel, but of course more than doxorotopotecan, which don't have the side effects. So this is one of the AEs you have to watch for. If you move over one more to kind of the middle of the screen, you see GI toxicities. We do see common but low-grade GI toxicities, nausea and diarrhea. These are very mitigatable with over-the-counter and then pre-medications for nausea and don't lead to drug discontinuations, but they're similar to chemotherapy because this is targeted chemotherapy. On the far right, you see what is the truly differentiated toxicity with mirvetuximab, and that's the ocular toxicity. And really the take-home is you could tell your patient, you have about a 50% chance of having an ocular disturbance on this medication. We have to be compliant with lubricating preservative-free eye drops and with any ocular symptoms such as blurry vision or dry eyes or eye pain that needs to be called in so that we can have the patient assessed by the ophthalmologist, hold the medication until it resolves to grade 1 or 0. Then often we can restart at the same dose, but sometimes we need to dose modify. But rarely do we have to discontinue. And in fact, the discontinuation rate due to ocular toxicities is less than 2%. So we have done a good job of mitigating this, but it is something our patients have to contend with while they're taking this medication. Now, SGO this year, we did reveal that my colleague presented the PRO data for mirvetuximab for the Mirasol study. And this is just a summary. I would refer you to the online presentation of this. But this just, I think, gives us another layer of comfort in using this medication in patients with platinum-resistant ovarian cancer. I'm just showing you the abdominal GI subscale here. You can see the number of symptoms that were assessed in the box. I'm not an expert at PRO, although I'm trying to become much better at it. But even I can understand that mirvetuximab looks better based on that figure. And so we do see, I like things that are clear to me. So we do see, again, not just efficacy, but also the patients are reporting that they feel better on this medication, which I think is important. What else is coming in mirvetuximab sortoflexacin? In the platinum-sensitive space, I'm hopeful this year, and I don't know this for a fact, I'm guessing, I'm hopeful you'll see the results of the Piccolo study, which is led by Dr. Angeles Alvarez-Secord. This is monotherapy mirvetuximab in a platinum-sensitive setting, but they have to have received at least two lines of platinum. So this is like third platinum-sensitive or beyond, a non-platinum regimen. And so I think we should be seeing these results later this year, and that will be exciting and quite frankly, an unmet need if that is positive. And then there are two other ongoing clinical trials, one replacing paclitaxel with mirvetuximab in combination with carboplatin in the platinum-sensitive space. That's called Study 420. And then, of course, the Phase 3 GLORIOSA study is open globally for folate receptor alpha high following response to platinum-based chemo and bevacizumab, and then randomized to bevacizumab alone or bevacizumab and mirvetuximab as another way to move mirvetuximab up a line of therapy. And you can see the schema at the bottom of this slide, and I would encourage you to screen for that trial if you have it open. There's other antibody drug conjugates targeting folate receptor alpha that are coming. So this is luveltamab, tazevibulin. This is a different agent. You know, it targets folate receptor alpha, but it has a different linker and it has a different cytotoxic payload. This is a hemiasterolin, microtubule toxin. My colleague to the right of me has led this this development and presented this clinical work. You can see her presentation. The waterfall plot is here, with a response rate in high expressors here by tumor proportion score. So it's a different scoring, is 37.5%. So a strong signal as this also moves into a registration enabling trial. And then we have other targets. Cadherin 6 or CDH6 is another transmembrane protein expressed in about 65 to 85% of epithelial ovarian cancer. This also has undergone phase one escalation and expansion studies, as you can see here. This is the drug relutotug deruxtecan, or RDXD. It moved into expansion cohorts. You can see in the lower right-hand side of this slide at the four dose levels that are listed. And then I was able to present updated data just yesterday. I've lost track of time. On the 45 patients at the three doses that are moving forward as all contenders for the recommended phase two dose. This drug has been incredibly well tolerated, with only 11% of patients discontinuing due to treatment emergent adverse events, only 15% requiring a dose reduction, and then interruptions in 31%. And in keeping with this class of agents, common but low grade GI toxicities, and the main hematologic toxicity we worry about is anemia at about 27% all grades. This is the response rate that I was able to show you yesterday, a confirmed overall response rate of just under 50%, with almost 100% disease control rate for the patients who have participated thus far. And this is moving in to a now activated, global registration-enabling phase 2-3 study that you can see here, led by Dr. Isabel Ray-Cucard globally and Deborah Richardson in the U.S. We're very excited about this in the platinum-resistant space. And it thus far is not biomarker limited. It's all comers, but we are still evaluating the biomarker correlation with response. There's a lot of other ADCs coming. Mesothelin is coming finally. Gosh, how many mesothelin ADCs have we tested? So there's one more coming because it's a good target. Let's just see if we can develop the right medicine for it. You heard already about TROP2. A lot of activity in TROP2 and endometrial, but this is a good target in ovarian cancer. DB1305, which is dualities, TROP2 with a topoisomerase inhibitor, has moved into an expansion cohort in ovary. So I look forward to seeing those responses. And there are others entering this space as well. So it's a little early, but we're excited to see how this performs in a platinum-resistant space. And then there's even more folate receptor alpha targeting ADCs that I've mentioned, many in phase one that we're excited about, too many to mention this morning, especially it's so early. But I think you're going to see a very differentiated panel of ADCs available across several different antigens, which is great for patients. And with that, I will stop and turn it back over to Dr. Monk. Thank you for your attention.
So here's a case for your consideration. Still, one of the more common, I'm not prepared to say most common regimens in frontline ovarian cancer, carboplatin paclitaxel alone. I would hope that that would be decreasing, but here's a patient that got that, HRD negative, and then ultimately recurred at 5 months, so a platinum-resistant patient. Folate receptor, 60% PS2, you have to have 75%. That happens in about 35% of patients. Unfortunately, this patient was unwilling to travel, and you didn't have a clinical trial for her at your site. So, Katie, these are some of the options: Aurelia, MIRV-BEV, PLD-BEV. How would you make this decision, and what would your recommendation be?
So, I mean, clearly, I'm worried about this patient recurring so quickly after finishing carboplatin and paclitaxel, and she's HRD test negative. So I think we have to just say the standard of care, the regulatory standard of care, is the Aurelia regimen. And I think we can all agree the best combination in that regimen is weekly paclitaxel and bevacizumab, just clearly. I don't think there's any question there. So that would be the standard of care that I would discuss with her. But I would say, and this is a U.S. opportunity only because of the NCCN listing, where mirvetuximab and bevacizumab have an NCCN 2B, it's hopefully going to be 2A soon, listing. And so we can access that combination. And the forward two data, which I didn't have time to show you, but we have 100 patients with platinum resistant and platinum sensitive, you know, but not appropriate for platinum, who were treated with this combination. And when you put the response rates up against weekly paclitaxel bevacizumab, it's very similar. It's 50%. And I know I'm comparing a phase 3 to a phase 2, but the phase 3 Aurelia, the subset that was paclitaxel bev, was not that many patients. So I'm kind of comparing similar numbers of patients. So I feel pretty comfortable in my practice because I can, using mirvetuximab and bevacizumab. It's every 3-week dosing. There's less neuropathy. There's no hair loss. There's far less hematologic toxicity. And it works quite nicely and patients feel well. So that's how I would counsel her. But I appreciate that regimen is not available in many parts of the world. And so if it wasn't an option, I would be using weekly pac bevacizumab.
And you notice she didn't even mention PLD. PLD is basically an inactive agent in ovarian cancer. I'm sorry to tell you guys that. It has a response rate of about 5 to 10%, and bevacizumab makes it about that much better. So, Anna, you're one of the world's leaders in clinical trials. What's the chance that that patient would go on a clinical trial in Barcelona?
In Barcelona, she has a high chance to get a clinical trial. So this patient will be enrolled in the Gloriosa trial, mirvetuximab plus bevacizumab, because she's the only option that she has to get mirvetuximab so far. Unfortunately, you know, in Europe, mirvetuximab is not approved according to the Mirasol and Soraya. You know, it takes a long time, so we expect the approval at the end of the year, early next one. So we try to enroll all patients in clinical trial, and mirve plus bev, it will be an excellent option for this patient. If we can recount the number of months, because it's just for 6 months, but we should review all the clinical data. In case that the patient was tied to 5 months, consider platinum resistant, then the option will be weekly paclitaxel plus bevacizumab.
Yeah, that's great. Well, thank you. This has been a good discussion. Patients with recurrent ovarian cancer, and quite frankly, all people that have cancer have a lot on their plate. We're going through that in my family, as some of you know. Clinical trials are indeed the best option. And just as we presented, occasionally patients need to travel. So we need to talk to patients how and when travel is appropriate. I think plan A always is to have clinical trials at your site, depending on where you're located, whether it's in Korea, go talk to Dr. Kim. Thank you. Good seeing you. Or Europe or the U.S., we want to help you get clinical trials to your site. There are many options. We're all huge fans of the advocacy platform. We were very honored to be partnered with NOC. They're an excellent resource, not just for patients, but also for you and your team. We utilize them frequently, if nothing more, a care package and a meal delivery. Okay, so they can do many, many things. And when it comes to clinical trials, FWC, which is our partner, as you know, within the GOG and the SGO, they can help identify clinical trials. And many of our clinical trials have travel budgets embedded. Okay, and we started that with our diversity opportunity, but it's not just for women in special populations. It's for all of our patients. So it's been my pleasure to be here with you. This has been so much fun. So thank you very much. Enjoy the day.
Thank you for listening. Download materials and complete the post-test for instant credit at peerview.com/VRN860. This activity is supported by independent educational grants from AstraZeneca, Daiichi Sankyo Incorporated, ImmunoGen Incorporated, Seagen, and Genmab. This activity is certified by PVI, PeerView Institute for Medical Education. This activity is developed with our educational partners, the Foundation for Women's Cancer and the National Ovarian Cancer Coalition. Remember to download the slides and practice aids.